In this video, we're going to compute the volume of an oblate spheroid by revolving the right half of the ellipse y squared over 4 plus x squared over 9 equals 1 about the y-axis, and then breaking the volume into cylindrical shells. So there's the oblate spheroid generated by our ellipse, and we can say this thing has semi-major axes of length 3 and a semi-minor axis of length 2. Where those semi-major axes are in the x and y directions, and the semi-minor axis of length 2 is in the z direction in our picture. So it's sort of a flattened sphere. We generated this by revolving the entire right half of our ellipse about the y-axis, but the calculation is going to be simpler if we revolve only the upper half of the ellipse and then double the result. So now we just revolve this section of the ellipse in the first quadrant, and that has the equation y equals 2 square root of 1 minus x squared over 9, just solving the ellipse equation for y and taking the positive result there. So this produces just the upper half of the spheroid. Next, we're going to propose that we fill this volume with nested thin cylindrical shells. So we visualize just one of these shells wrapping around the y-axis. And that's going to give us an incremental contribution to the total volume contained within the upper half of the spheroid. So the next thing we need to do is figure out the dimensions of this shell. And we start with the radius, which we're going to call x. And that goes from 0 to 3 as we nest our shells to fill the entire ellipsoid from the center out to the edge. Now let's go ahead and label the height of this shell. And that height is just going to be the y value on that curve describing this ellipse in the first quadrant. So it's 2 square root 1 minus x squared over 9. Finally, we're going to label the thickness of the shell wall. And that thickness is an infinitesimal value that we're going to call dx. Okay, now that we have the dimensions of a representative shell completely labeled, we're going to slice this thing vertically and then unroll it into a rectangular slab. And the height of that slab is the exact same y value. It's 2 square root 1 minus x squared over 9. The thickness of the slab is the same thing as the thickness of the shell wall, and that's our incremental value dx. Finally, the length of the slab is the same thing as the circumference of our shell before we cut and unrolled it. So we use the circumference formula 2 pi r, but the radius of the shell was x. So the length of our slab is 2 pi x. So now it's simple to calculate the volume contribution of our shell. We just need to get the volume of this rectangular solid by multiplying all three dimensions. And this gives us an infinitesimal volume contribution that we call dv, and it's given by 4 pi x times the square root of 1 minus x squared over 9 times dx. And with that entire volume contribution phrased in terms of a single variable x, we're now ready to use integration to add up all these volume contributions and find the total. And I'm going to write v is equal to the sum of all the dv's. This is what an integral does. It's a summation device for adding up all these continuously changing infinitesimal quantities. So now we just have to sub in our dv and our limits of integration. And dv is given by 4 pi x times the square root of 1 minus x squared over 9 dx. And we're adding up the volumes of these shells all the way from x equals 0 to x equals 3. And we're in luck on this integral because if I look at the interior of this square root, the derivative of that is negative 2x over 9. And we have an x in our integrand. This should allow us to build the derivative of the interior function into our integrand, which makes it easy to see the chain rule backwards. So in the next step, I'm going to get the 4 pi out in front, just out of the way, and leave a little extra space for the adjustment of constants. And what I'm going to do is multiply this x inside the integrand by negative 2/9. So I have negative 2/9 x, and then I have to compensate out in front by multiplying by negative 9/2. So that produces a minus sign and then a 9/2. And then I'm going to represent my square root with a fractional power just to make it easier to take the antiderivative. So I have 1 minus x squared over 9 to the 1/2. Okay, so things clean up a little bit out in front. I can cancel a factor of 2, and this leaves me with a negative 18 pi. And then because I constructed the derivative of the interior function inside my integrand, it makes it easy to see the effects of the chain rule. And all we have to be concerned with in terms of guessing the antiderivative here is applying the power rule to this expression, 1 minus x squared over 9. So we add 1 to the exponent. That gives us 1 minus x squared over 9 to the 3 halves. And then we have to divide by 3 halves, which is the same as multiplying by 2 thirds. And this whole thing is going to be evaluated from 0 to 3. Now we can clean things up a little bit out in front, canceling a factor of 3. And that leaves us with a negative 12 pi out in front. And then we look at what happens when we evaluate across the limits of integration. If I sub in x equals 3 in this expression, it gives me a 1 minus 1, which is 0. So that piece is gone. And then we need to subtract what we get when we sub in x equals 0. Well, that just gives me a 1 for that expression in the parentheses. And this is a good thing. This fixes the minus sign because we know we have to come out with a positive volume for this object. Now the final step here is that we have to remember everything we just did was to find the volume of the upper half of this oblate spheroid. So we just have to multiply by 2 and we arrive at an exact volume for this oblate spheroid of 24 pi. If you enjoyed this video or at least found it useful, check out another one by clicking one of the links on the left. Or click the Zach's Lab logo on the right to explore dozens of physics and math playlists. As always, you can leave your questions, comments, and requests in the comments section below, and I'll get back to you within 24 hours. Thanks for watching Zach's Lab, and best of luck on your math and physics journey.